I'm going to spend a little time explaining the process before all the lights go out. Because I think information is power. The more you understand the process, the more you can identify ways that we can help you. The Board of Review is an agency that consists of three commissioners. It serves as like an appellate court in that it reviews challenges to the assessed values that the assessor places on property. Rather than just going back to the assessor and saying you're wrong, you get the opportunity to both go to the assessor and give him a chance to change the assessment if he's wrong, or go to an independent agency, the Board of Review, to say the assessor is wrong, he got my assessed value wrong. That way, an independent group of commissioners is looking at the value that the assessor set. We have no vested interest in maintaining the value the assessor set. And the law actually gives us the authority to reduce the value that the assessor set based upon evidence that he has overvalued your property. Now, the value of your property is one of many different components of your tax bill that goes into calculation of your bill. When we talk about things we can do and things we cannot do, we can help you where the property is over-assessed to get the value used to determine your taxes more, to be a more accurate value. And again, we do that based upon evidence we find or evidence you submit. Your tax bill is also comprised of tax rates from the different taxing bodies and taxing districts, such as park districts, school districts, the county, your local municipality, water reclamation district, and different others. Those rates can change depending on the budgets that those different governing bodies need to run their operation. If they raise their budgets and raise their tax rates, sometimes even a reduction we give you in the value can still result in a higher tax bill, but it would be even higher if we didn't reduce the value. So basically, the value of your property is applied to those tax rates to determine what your tax bill will look like. We are evaluating that value to try and get it as low as possible. So why do we come out and do this every year? When I first ran, there was a lot of suggestion that the downtown businesses were getting improper reductions in their values. I'll tell you, we have not really found inappropriate reductions in downtown businesses. What we really found was that everyday homeowners didn't have the same access. They weren't aware of the filing periods, and they didn't understand the process. So we can, every year, the downtown Chicago businesses file property tax bills. Every year. They are arguing that they should owe lower taxes every year. And we have made a concentrated effort to come out to the citizens every year to encourage them to file, to show them how to file, to give them the opportunity to file in a number of different ways, both in these forms, and we've created an online system where you can do it in 5 minutes from your home or your phone, okay? That, again, is to give more homeowners the opportunity to file so that they're paying taxes on accurate values, not inaccurate values. So let's talk about the types of evidence that's relevant. There was a time when our values of our properties would go up every year, and the county's triennial process of reassessing one-third of the county every 3 years benefited you because, let's say they assessed your property at $100,000, that property value would be used to calculate your tax bill for the next 3 years. And usually our properties would go up every 3 years, so you'd be paying taxes on that initial value. When our properties lost value though, meaning they went from, let's say, that $100,000 down to $85,000 or $90,000 that second year or that third year, you were still paying taxes on the $100,000. So our goal, when we saw a decline in values and we faced the real estate crisis that we faced back in 08, 09, around that area, we thought it was prudent for everyday homeowners to do like downtown businesses and file every year so that they could get the benefit of any reduction in value of their property when they're paying that year's taxes. So we encourage people to file every year so that you're paying taxes on an accurate value of your property, not some artificially inflated or predetermined value from a prior year. Our process is one that will not hurt you. meaning that if we find evidence that your property is worth more than the assessor has said, we are not increasing the value of your property. We do either a no change, meaning leave the value where the assessor said it, or we reduce it based upon evidence to support a reduction. Okay? So there's no harm or risk to you in filing an appeal of seeing us increase the value of your property. We either no change it, leaving it where the assessor said it, or grant you a reduction. And historically, between 6 to 7 or 8 of every 10 people that file have seen some reduction in the value used to calculate their bill. So a majority of people who file, we find some evidence to support a reduction. And again, that's something you should do on an annual basis. So let's talk about the type of evidence that's relevant. Old appraisal theory would say that you utilize appraisals to determine value and you utilize market sales, because a market sale, meaning a house that someone bought like yours in the market, is the best evidence of the value of the property because it's what somebody paid. The problem, though, that we found in the last several years, particularly in the south suburbs, is the foreclosure crisis. People will not pay market value for houses when they can buy foreclosed houses in the same neighborhood for much cheaper prices. Foreclosures historically were not considered true market value sales, so they were excluded because they represented distress sales, not market sales, so they weren't a reflection of market value. We revamped the way we look at foreclosure sales when we see numerous and an abundant number of foreclosure sales, because again, no one is going to pay market value if they can go buy a foreclosure in the same neighborhood. So when we see evidence of multiple foreclosures or abandoned properties that appear to be subject to foreclosure, and we get evidence of that, we will utilize a sufficient number of those to define that as the new market value. Meaning, even though you paid $100,000, if there are 5 bungalows like yours within a reasonable distance of your property, and they're going for $50,000, that's probably more accurately the new market value in that area. We just need evidence of that. In our office, we get evidence of sales that occur in the area, and we get evidence of the values that the assessor set. What we can do with those is to say, if this gentleman has filed an appeal, and the assessor assesses value of property at $100,000, and we see sales at $75,000 of properties just like his, we can reduce his value to the $75,000 based upon the market sales. We also can utilize the assessor's determination that these 3 houses on the same block that are just the same type of house, that the assessor valued at $75,000, we can use those as evidence of a lack of uniformity and reduce that gentleman's property to the $75,000 so there's uniformity. The problem, though, when you have foreclosures, is that with foreclosures, sometimes if you have uniformly elevated artificial value of property, it doesn't help you for me to make you the same as those overvalued properties. So we need you to help us identify foreclosed properties, abandoned properties, properties that have been on the MLS or have been listed for sale for extended periods of time, to show that the assessor's value is not accurate. So let's talk about what I mean by MLS listings. Using the same example, if the assessor assesses this gentleman's property at $100,000, and there are 2 like that property on the same block that have been for sale for 2 years for $75,000, and nobody buys them, that's evidence that the market value of $100,000 is too high, because no one's paying $75,000 for the same house. The problem is I don't have evidence of those. I have evidence of sales, and I have evidence of other assessed values the assessor set. You can help us by identifying those properties that have been on the market for extended periods of time at prices lower than your house to show us that the market is not, the market, no one is paying $75,000 in the market, so my house is overvalued at $100,000. That's one example of how you can help us by giving us evidence we don't have that we include in your file when we determine an appropriate value of your property. Let me give you another example. A lot of people were encouraged to refinance their properties. And the bank would say, here, you can refinance, we have low rates, pay $500 for an application fee, go over here to this appraiser, pay $1,000 for this appraisal, you submit all that information, and they tell you, I'm sorry, you don't have any equity in your house. Okay. Thank you for the $500. Thank you for the $1,000 for the appraisal. So downtown businesses and commercial properties annually buy appraisals to support their appeals. It's hard for us to tell homeowners to go spend $1,000 on an appraisal. So rather than do that, what we've decided to do is ask you if you have appraisals, even if they're a bit dated, meaning they're a year or two or even 3 years old, if you give us those, we will factor those into our determination of value of the property. So even if you tried to refinance your property and they determined that the value is too low based on an appraisal, if you give us that, that gives us some additional evidence that we can use to determine what is an accurate value of your property. Okay, again, I wouldn't encourage you to go buy an appraisal, but where you have those and they show your property has been overvalued, submit those and we'll consider them. Anybody familiar with Zillow? Zillow is an online tool that you can use. Many properties can type in their address and it'll show sales in the area and it will show the value of your property. Zillow's not always right, but it's not always wrong. And you can even submit something like a Zillow valuation of your property. We may not follow to the T the Zillow determination, but again, it gives us some additional information that we don't have with respect to sales in your area, and even sometimes a value that Zillow is attributing to your specific property. So those are a couple of examples of the types of things you can do to help us help you support your appeal challenging the assessed value of your property. Again, we can only help you with the value you use to calculate your bill. We cannot help you with the various tax rates. Does that make sense? So let's talk about the tax rates a little bit, because in the south suburbs in particular, they can be very high. Many of the south suburban communities have higher tax rates. Most of them, if not all, have higher tax rates than the city of Chicago. Why is that? The example I like to give is the general answer to that question is that in the city of Chicago, you have a vibrant downtown commercial business community, and those commercial businesses are contributing to the tax obligations for funding government. In the south suburbs, we've seen a lot of business flight, and we don't have the businesses that we used to have to share the tax obligations. That means that the obligations of funding local government fall on the backs of the homeowners primarily, okay? Which is why you see some alternative taxes being proposed. Many, if not all of them, are unpopular. The cigarette taxes, the pop tax, things like that, are efforts to alternatively tax different things so that you don't have to additionally tax property owners. But in the south suburbs, you see these high tax rates because, again, it's falling on the backs of homeowners. So let's explain how that works, because a lot of people don't understand how their value of the property can go down, but their taxes can go up. That doesn't seem to make sense, right? Am I boring?
Oh, no. Keep going.
All right. So let's talk about it. I'm going to use an easy example. If we have a city that has 10 houses in the whole city, no other businesses, all the houses are the same, and it costs $1,000 to fund the government, okay? And the houses are all the same, every house will pay $100. So all 10 houses will pay $100 in taxes. That would fund the $1,000 in government to fund government, okay? Let's say the same community, but they have to buy a new fire truck, okay? That fire truck costs an extra $1,000. Now, instead of $1,000, it costs $2,000 to fund that government. Those same houses, because of the increase in need in government, will now pay $200 each. Each of the 10 houses will pay $200 to fund the now $2,000 needed to fund government, okay? And that's with the houses not changing in value. What has changed is the governmental need in terms of what it costs to fund government. Let's take the same, let's go to the next year. We bought the fire truck, we're back to $1,000 to fund government, okay? But we get a real estate crisis and our properties all drop in in value. Half. So now properties that were worth $100,000 are now worth $50,000. But guess what? It still costs $1,000 that year to fund the government. So now these houses that were worth $100,000, these 10 houses that were worth $100,000 that are now worth $50,000 still have to pay $100 each to fund the $1,000 it costs to fund government. If government goes up, property values go down. So again, we bought a new fire truck. Those houses that went from $100,000 down to $50,000 now have to bear the burden of funding this $2,000 because of the new fire truck. So now they drop 50% in value, but their taxes that they increase to $200 each because it costs $1,000 to fund government and they bought a new fire truck for another $1,000. So basically, funding government largely and predominantly falls on the backs of homeowners. And the fight that homeowners have is to reduce the values to accurate values that they're paying, because your value represents your percentage of responsibility for that funding of government. Let me use this example as to that. If we have the same 10 houses, one of the houses doubles the value of their property because they add, they double their square footage, okay? So now their house goes from $100,000 to $200,000. Your house has dropped in value from $100,000 to $50,000, okay? For whatever reason. They, in increasing their square footage, have increased their percentage of responsibility for funding government. They will pay a higher tax, you will pay a lower tax, because you have a smaller percentage of that overall tax obligation based on the value of your house. Okay, so when we come here to have you challenge your assessed values, we're trying to get you to accurate values, so you're paying your fair share of the percentage of tax obligations due to fund government. Again, the downtown businesses do it every year. When they get appeals granted, that obligation doesn't go away, it shifts to homeowners. We want thousands and thousands and thousands of homeowners who are entitled to reductions to get those, so that whatever obligation should be shifted back to the commercial properties is shifted back. It doesn't rest on rent every day. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
A little bit? With that, we will, let me tell you a quick way to just take a quick look at your tax bill. Over the last 4 or 5 years, there have been significant changes in the tax bill that you get, in that they include a market value on your tax bill. For residential homeowners, the assessed value is 10% of the market value. They actually also include the market value on the bill. So you can look, and generally people know about what their house is worth. If the bill says your house is worth $120,000, you know that your house is probably worth about $100,000. You can eyeball that and say, I should probably file an appeal. Okay, I may have a basis to get a reduction. If you think it may be right, but you're not sure, file an appeal. Because we may have evidence from one of your neighbors to show the values based on some appraisal they filed is actually lower than the assessor determined. Okay, so again, we think you should file every year so that we are looking at the values you're paying taxes on an accurate value. Let's talk about Cook County and how it taxes. It taxes 1 year in arrears. So this appeal process that you're going through today is not to help you with the current tax bill. It is to help you with the second installment tax bill that you will get next July. Okay, how does that work? The process of determining your tax bill takes almost a year. The assessor determines the value of your property. The assessor then has an appeal process, so you can challenge it at his or her office. After he has his appeal process, the Board of Review opens, so you can file an appeal with our office. That process takes several months to complete. Once that's done, the values are transmitted to Springfield, where they determine an equalization factor to try and equalize the taxes due across the state. And then the different taxing bodies develop their budgets and their tax levies all of which go into determining the tax rates that will be applied to the value. So since that process takes about a year, Cook County tax is 1 year in arrears. The value that you're appealing today will be used as the value that all of those tax rates will be applied to generate your second installment bill. So the goal is to get that value lower so that when they apply those tax rates, it's applied to an accurate value. Do you know how to determine what your first installment bill will be next year? Okay, let's talk about that. You really owe one amount of taxes for a given year. Because the process takes almost a year to complete, rather than hitting you with one large bill, the county splits your bill into two. One bill you get in the spring, one bill you get in July, on July 1st. The bill you get in the spring is an estimated bill, which you can calculate today. It will be 55% of the total amount of taxes you paid the prior year. So, as an example, if all of the taxes you paid this year that were due around August 1st, if that totaled $1,000 between your first and second installment, meaning not just the second bill, all of it, then your spring installment bill will be 55% of that, or $550. You can calculate it today, you'll know exactly what your bill is going to be. If you look at what you pay in total this year and multiply 0.55, you will know what your spring bill will be. As they go through the process of determining tax rates, value, and values, and they come to that final tax bill, they are simply deducting whatever you pay toward the total that you owe. So if we, for instance, were able to reduce your total tax bill from $1,000 to $800 and you paid $550 in your first installment next year, you'd only owe an additional $250 to get to the $800 in your second installment. So we're trying to help you reduce the value that's used to determine your bill so that your second installment bill will be lower than you paid the prior year. Your first installment bill is an estimate. It's not something we can help you with. Again, it's 55% of what you paid in 2017. Does that make sense? All right. I think I'm losing a few people. So we're going to go to some questions and answers. Anybody have questions? Yes, sir.
Yes. When I reduce your bill, would it be with the money you send back to you, or would it go into your escrow? Would you get a check for the reduction?
Good question. So first of all, whatever bill you get, you have to pay. If you don't pay your tax bill, it's subject to sale for taxes, and someone can try to secure your property if you don't redeem it within a reasonable amount of time. I believe it's 2 years at this point. Actually, I think Rounder may have reduced it to one, actually. If you get a reduction in your tax bill, okay, you need to communicate that to your mortgage company so that they adjust the amount that they collect from you in escrow, all right? So that's not something we do. The tax bill simply gets generated after all these processes are completed. You need to communicate to your mortgage company what your ultimate tax bill is. They're very sharp on noticing when your taxes go up, because they increase your mortgage, because they increase the amount you have to escrow. They're a little slower about reducing it when you get a reduction in tax. Yes, ma'am.
I purchased a home last year and had a senior exemption on it. So for the second half for next year, for 2016, would I still get that because I purchased it in June? So would it still apply for that, or will the tax amount go up?
Is that your senior exemption?
No.
Okay. So.
No.
I thought you might have married an older man. First of all, exemptions are personal to the owner. They do not follow the property. So you have to be very careful not to claim exemptions you are not entitled to, because you can be subject to fines and penalties. And they are aggressively going after people who improperly claim things like homeowners exemptions. Okay? So it's important to note that exemptions do not follow the property, they follow the homeowner. If you live in the home, you're entitled to a homeowner's exemption for living in the home. If you're a senior and you meet the qualifications for a senior exemption, then you qualify for a senior exemption on your tax bill. So it sounds to me, I haven't looked at anything, but it sounds to me like you're too young to have a senior's exemption.
You're correct.
So you should correct it. Anyone else? Yes, ma'am?
I'm having problems trying to identify the dates when you can appeal this assessment.
Okay. That's a very good question. I'll explain that process. So because our process follows the assessor, meaning he assesses properties, he determines value. Once he certifies his assessed values, then we open up the townships based upon those that he's decided already for appeals. There are 38 townships in Cook County. The assessor reassesses one-third of them every 3 years. But he determines values for all of them every year. He reassesses townships in different order, okay? So we can't formally open our appeal process until the assessor has formally determined the values for that area, okay? What we have done, and that's a complicated system, meaning he may close the township. He may close Calumet Township September 1st. We might open it October 1st, and then it's only formally open for about a 30-day period. So homeowners used to have that 30-day period to file only. So we would publish notice in the newspaper that Calumet Township was open, and people would have to catch it and then file. So what we have done to modify that is to open all townships for filing until they formally close, okay? Meaning, if the township is not formally opened at the Board of Review and you go online or you come here and you file, we consider that to be a pre-filing, and it will be formally filed when the township opens, but you have already taken care of it because you've already submitted your paperwork. So we accept paperwork on unopened townships as pre-filings. We do that, and we come out aggressively in July, August, and September. We try to go to all the townships because none of the townships have closed by September 1, and everybody can pre-file by that date. So again, we try to encourage people while their tax bill is on their mind when they get it in July to file their property tax assessment appeal in July, in August. While your current tax bill is on your mind, go ahead to the Board of Review website and pre-file for the next year. That way it's done.
Okay.
We're here right now, and Calumet Township is not open. So we're here accepting appeals. This is Bremen, but here's Calumet. Calumet also received notice that we would be here as well. Bremen Township, I believe, closes on the 26th. August 26th, September 26th, next Tuesday. So we're here during the time period that Bremen Township is open. We also try to go to every township while it's actually open as well.
The city of Chicago still open?
The city of Chicago is broken into multiple townships. Most of those have not opened yet at the Board of Review. That is a change. We've been doing that now for probably the past 4 to 5 years, and we've done that again so people, everyday homeowners, have more of an opportunity to file as opposed to just a 30-day window. Also, I would encourage you to go to our website at cookcountyboardofreview.com. On our website, we just won an award for the website. What we've established is the ability for homeowners to set up accounts. By setting up an account and filing every year, you will have access to all your former filings, any evidence you submitted, like appraisals, any photographs you uploaded. You'll receive an email response from us confirming that we received your appeal. We can then communicate results to you by email. It's a much easier process for homeowners. It takes about 5 minutes. So we'd encourage you to set up accounts. Also, it will allow us at appropriate times to communicate with you by email, such as when your township opens. Yes?
You mentioned earlier about the exemptions. It follows the owner, correct?
Correct.
So I have a situation where I own two properties. One I live in, one I rent to my sister. She's been in the property for about 15 years now. I've never gotten any type of discount on it because I've always knew that, or at least I thought I knew that. But I see on this paper here, it says tenant liable for tax.
It says what?
It says tenant liable for tax. So what exactly does that mean? I don't charge her laundry rent, but she does give me money to cover the tax because we don't have that agreement.
Sure. We would need to, let us take a look at your bill. We have some analysts here just to look at it. I don't want to speak out of turn because I haven't seen it yet. Yes, sir.
About once every 6 months, I get a letter from an attorney that said that you need something that you need thousands of dollars back from the tax system. I don't trust people too much, so I've never done it. Is that legitimate?
So, you don't need an attorney to, in my opinion, to file a residential property tax bill on the property that you own. We're here to explain the process. If you do nothing but fill out the form, we'll do a uniformity and sales analysis. If you have additional information, you can upload it or provide it to us. A lot of the companies, lawyers are like plumbers, okay? I'm a lawyer. Plumber, meaning that you get what you pay for. There are some lawyers who will do a property tax appeal for you, and they will ask you for appraisals. They'll recommend you get an appraisal. They'll ask you for specific information about your property. And there are some lawyers who will get you to just sign up, giving them the authority to submit a form with no evidence, and just based on statistics, you get a reduction, you got to pay it. Okay, so to be very frank about it, I don't think you need a lawyer. I'm explaining the process to you. We've created a process where you can file here. You can give us evidence here. You can go online and submit it and upload pictures, other types of evidence to support your appeal. Or you can just submit the form and we'll do an analysis for you. You shouldn't have to pay a lawyer to do that. And you don't. Lawyers get no preferential treatment from our office whatsoever. Yes, sir.
Earlier you gave an example about having a house worth $100,000 and then another house in your neighborhood was trying to be sold for $75,000 and it couldn't sell. So you said that you would need to provide evidence for that. What would be sufficient evidence of that?
So when I speak of evidence, I'm not speaking of evidence that you need for a court of law. It doesn't have to be formal. We want to make it as easy for taxpayers as possible. So you could submit an MLS listing, which is a listing service that provides the time frame that a property has been listed, as well as the amount it's been listed for, and it'll even show the changes in listed price. Or you can submit a newspaper article, I'm sorry, an ad in the newspaper that shows that the property has been listed, you know, for a year. It needs to be for probably at least a year, so that we know that property is not sold for about that length of time, despite an asking price below the value of your property. Okay? I'm not saying if you submit one of those to us, you get a reduction. I'm saying that gives us additional information to factor into the uniformity and sales analysis that we do when you file the appeal. So it's something else that we can consider, and that type of evidence would be supportive of a reduction.
One more question.
Yes.
Okay. So if I have appraised value disclosure and from buying a new home, okay, an appraised value disclosure, what else do I need to provide to you guys with that disclosure?
When you call it an appraised value disclosure, that's related to a new purchase?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay. You can supply that to us. Is that based on an appraisal?
Yes.
Okay. So you can supply us the full appraisal if you have the full appraisal. or whatever evidence is provided. Appraisals are probably some of the quality appraisals are some of the best evidence outside of sales as to what market value is. Because appraisals, if they're done right, they will look at other properties in the area, they will look at sales, they will look at differences and variances between properties and make adjustments and determine a value for that property. So,
disclosure is all you guys need?
I would submit the entire appraisal if you can, because we want to see the basis of the conclusion. So it should identify and have pictures of other properties that they use as the basis of the conclusion.
But we don't need like another form, a cover letter?
No, you can just apply it. The easiest way is to go online. You can actually upload the appraisal and it'll go into your file that we'll consider for this appeal.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, sir.
What if you're in an impoverished neighborhood that has been named impoverished? I live in Deer Point. Our neighborhood has been in foreclosure and our taxes had not changed. Our taxes were really still sky high. But there were board ups, the neighborhood was in foreclosure, and our taxes were still up there. What do we do in that place, in that spot? Well, we did appeal our taxes, but our taxes are still high.
It can be a little more challenging when you're in foreclosure, in communities with a lot of foreclosures for this reason. When properties are in foreclosure, they have not yet sold. So we pick up sales, and we don't pick up just foreclosure filings. But if you provide us information on, you know, the number of foreclosures, you can give us the addresses, you can take pictures and upload them, and we see a number of foreclosures, I think we can reasonably include those in our determination of your value, because that's going to affect the value of your property. No one's going to pay market value for your property if you get all these foreclosed and boarded up properties around. So we would try, anytime we can give you some benefit by factoring in those types of you know, relevant factors, we give you the benefit. Right? The challenge also becomes determining whether the assessor has already considered those issues. Okay, meaning he has lowered the values of your properties already based upon the numbers of foreclosures in the area. So we have to be careful and balance that and make sure we're not double counting factors that have already been included when your value is determined. But that's an example when you need to help us help you. Give us the addresses, give us the pictures, show us, you know, the proximity of those properties to yours so that we get a better context of what's going on with your property.
That was done, and then I even went back, and they told me that I couldn't even appeal my taxes. That was done with pictures, that was done with addresses, and it was sent to the review board. And the response that came back was that you it's a 3-year wait, and you still have to wait these 3 years, and then we'll see what we can do then.
Yeah, I'd have to look at the letter. We can look up your property. One reason we bring the analysts out specifically, these are people who actually decide the appeals, is so they can hear what you're saying, and you can get a card from an analyst to follow up with them directly so we can look into what happened in that situation. I can't comment on it without looking at it. This man in the back.
I want to know, how they calculate your exemptions?
Our office does not handle the exemptions. They're handled by the assessor's office. We have them here today, and they can answer more specific questions about that. Okay. Yes, ma'am. Sounds like you were entitled to an exemption. They didn't get your annual.
They didn't get the annual.
Okay, so the assessor's office is where you would typically mail that into. They're here today. Make them fix it. These two nice young people right here are going to help you with that. Okay.
No senior exemption, homestead, or anything. You can get anything. Zero.
Was this helpful to you?
Yes.
Okay, so please tell your family, friends, and your neighbors about our website. It's cookcountyboardofreview.com. The more people that file in your community, the better context we have for what's happening in the community, what the values are. We may get appraisals from your neighbors on your block, other additional information to help more people. The more people that get reductions here, the more people will benefit from the process. Again, every year, downtown businesses do it every year, okay? So we want you to get in the habit of doing it every year so you're not paying more than your fair share. Thank you again for coming out, and we'll be in the back here to answer some more individual questions.